We are live. Angela, hello, how are you? And our guest tonight, this is a very special night. Our guest is Julia Hanna, and she has been a host on this show many, many times, but this time she is the main guest. And without further ado, let me introduce Julia Hanna. Hi, Julia.
Hi, how are you doing?
Fine. How are you? It's so great to see you.
I know. I've been away for a bit. It's exciting to be back on, and I've been watching like a lot of the live streams. Like the one with David McElroy was really interesting. I really enjoyed it.
Yeah. So we have quite a lineup, but I'm so excited about the fact that in April, you've committed to co-host. Every Friday, and that is so wonderful. So wonderful to have you back.
I'm excited to be back, yeah, for sure.
And Angela says, hi, Julia.
Hi, Angela, and hi, William.
Yeah, William says, okay, which is, I guess, his signature.
Yeah, that's William. He's fun.
Yeah, okay. And, you know, because a few weeks ago, somebody was asking, actually, who is Julia? And what, you know, they were like, what is her connection to Bo? Because everybody thinks this is the Bo channel, you know.
I mean, it's the Bo research channel.
Right, exactly. So I thought we would share with everyone how you first met Bo. And that was actually the first time I ever saw you. You know, I mean, we used to write on Hub Pages, and then we became friends on Facebook. Then I wanted to interview you because I was getting interested in having a show in which I do interviews on my channel. So we got together. We wanted to do it on Skype. Remember Skype? At that time, that's what we were doing, you know, and later we used other services, and right now we're using StreamYard. But at the time, that was the thing, you know, if you wanted to get together with someone online and see each other. But so we were going to test it. And of course, during the day, I'm always with Bo. So anything I do, Bo is involved with. Were you shocked when you saw him, or how did you feel?
I mean, I feel like I kind of annoyed him. Like, I feel like he didn't like what I was asking him, because I'm like, oh, do you like fruit? I think it was just annoying to him. That's kind of what I felt like. I'm like, oh, sorry.
Well, it's not personal. It's just, you know, William loves to watch Bo display. And he said he thought that it wouldn't be very interesting tonight because all he wants to do is watch Bo display at Leo. But actually, anytime Bo meets somebody new, he feels that he has to display. So you were not annoying him. He was just trying to test you and to show you that he was very big and strong. And that's what he does for everybody when they, you know, when he meets them for the first time.
For sure.
And what's funny is if you watch it to the end, you'll see that he wasn't boisterous at all at the end. When I said, okay, bye. And, the moment he knew that you were going away, he sat down very quietly.
It was kind of like, he's like, I'm a ham for the camera. Look at me.
Right. So let me go ahead and share that one. So what we saw at the beginning, that was a sped up version without the sound. Yay. So this is our first meeting.
2012, right? I think.
Yeah, it was 11 years ago.
Yeah, amazing.
Yeah. Hey, want me to move aside so he can show you what a big boy he is?
Let me get it back to the beginning. This is where it's going. Open your
phone. Open your cover now. Hey. He wants me to move aside so he can show you what a big boy he is.
Wow, you are
pretty
tall.
Can you talk to him? Just say something soothing. Tell him you're in a truck.
I'm your friend. How are you? I wish something about the internet, though. I really like things about you. It's really interesting to hear about you.
Come on. Hey.
Do you have a favorite movie you
okay. Right. You know what? There's the problem also with the sound because I can only hear part of what you're saying.
Oh.
There's also a problem with the sound. We need to get all of the difficulties resolved. Can you hear everything I say or do I
can hear. I can hear everything you're saying, but I don't know. Is that better? I can hear the sound at all. Is still cutting out?
A little bit.
Might be my connection because I have a DSL connection and I know it's a little slow. I've thought about going back to cable internet and I haven't done a video chat, so I don't know. It might be the connection.
You know what? I think that was probably not going to let us do it this morning, but actually when you talk, when you say a full sentence, it gets better. It's just because we're cutting each other off because he's making a lot of noise, so that cuts off your voice. So I think we probably better sign off right now because he's not in a mood for this. Okay. What time do you have over there right now? What time is it there?
Right now it's 6:27, but I'm not going to be back till later tonight because I work like after I leave at 10. So I'm not.
Oh, okay. All right.
I'm home all day tomorrow.
I'll tell you what. Let's just sign off, and I will get in touch with you on Facebook, and we'll make an appointment for this evening, or if not this evening, some other evening. So let's look like we'll want to have us do this.
Good. Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. Bye.
Bye.
Okay. So can you see? How calm.
Oh, I see. Yeah, he looks really happy. He's so little. He looks so
yeah.
little.
Yeah. He looks so like a the moment we signed off, he knew it was the time to have a display show to show you how strong and scary he is. That was over. And he just became this very calm chimpanzee looking at the screen.
I love seeing the footage too, because we like I just 11 years ago, it's very fun.
Yeah. You were younger. I was younger. Bo was younger. We were all younger.
It was very cute. I have now that I look back, because at the time I thought, oh gosh, I must have annoyed him. But now I have a new appreciation. I can see that he was displaying. I kind of get it now.
Yeah. I mean, that's what he does for everything. Yeah. So somebody wants to talk about baboons in Australia. I don't know much about baboons or Australia, so I'm going to refrain from having an opinion on that. You know, sometimes we don't know, so it's better not.
Yeah, we don't know. But what we could suggest is if the person wants to come back, they could tell us in the video comments later if they learn more about it or something, you know?
Yeah. So anyway, that's what Bo used to do. And, you know, I was with him and still am with him, mm-hmm. you know, 12 hours a day. And if I wanted to do something else like talk to you, I had to get Bo's permission to do that. And later on, we did meet. And it wasn't all about Bo, because I didn't think my channel was all about Bo at all. And it was about you. It was interview with you.
That was fun. I really liked that concept of how you were going to do, and well, it became a channel, like it's part of your channel, you know, it's really cool.
Yeah. Yeah. And you were the first person that I ever interviewed for this channel. So would you like me to share that now?
The interview? Yes. Let's watch that.
Okay.
When did you decide that you were a writer?
Okay. Well, let me I think that over again. Here we go.
Have you been writing all your life, or when did you decide that you were a writer?
Well, I think I decided like when I was 10, I had a diary and I would write little stories, and I always wanted to write a book because my friends always said I was really good at writing fiction, and I never really got serious about it until HuffPages, because I used to be a teacher
I hated that, but something about Hub Pages gave me a chance to start writing and get into it, so that's how I kind of got back into it, and now, you know, I'm working on my novel, and through Hub Pages, I think, you know, I learned a lot that I like writing.
Well, I don't know what to ask about first, your Hub Pages experience, maybe, and then we'll get into your novel. So, you were on Hub Pages longer than I was. You were one of the veterans when I joined. How did you find Hub Pages?
Okay, it's so funny, but I found them on, I think, Craigslist. They were advertising something about jobs for writing, and I just really liked the site, and I made a couple hubs, and it was really nice and friendly in the beginning. It's not bad now, it's still good, it just got bigger, and I liked it when it was smaller, because I'm more into smaller things, and more supportive back then, like in 2008, I really liked it back then. It's just a little big now, I don't have a problem with it, that's one thing I like about your site, that it's kind of small. That's what I like.
Yeah, I like small homey things. I even like, you know, universities that are smaller and departments that are smaller, because you get to know everybody. So same thing, I think, you know, when you've got a smaller site. So your novel is set in Hawaii, is that right?
It is in California and Hawaii. Most of it takes place in Hawaii. The first part's in California. It's about this woman, based on my experience. She was a teacher. She hated it. And she goes to Hawaii on vacation, and she loves Hawaii. And she ends up, you know, coming back to California, but a few years later, she decides to go back to Hawaii. So the duration, the rest of the novel takes place in Hawaii. It's kind of like a modern romance novel, but not like Harlequin. Like, there's modern takes on things. So I'm on page 200, and I'm still working and seeing where it evolved from there, you know. So it's exciting.
Okay, tell me a little bit about hating teaching, because you don't hear that a lot, but, you know, I feel a lot of sympathy. So tell me.
Well, it's not that I hate it. I mean, I do sub occasionally, but what I didn't like, had bad experiences. Like, I had a kid threw a ball on my head and just, like, crazy stuff, and, like, parents that would, just like, I taught in places that were really isolated, and just, it wasn't a good community, so it's not that I hate teaching, I just don't want to do it after those experiences. When you had a parent tell you that they might kill you because their son was acting up in class, and you let them know about it, that's kind of scary, you know? It scares me a little bit, so I just wanted space away from it, and that's why I left teaching. I feel better out of it, and you know, working at a library is a little bit more my personality, because I never liked taking charge, and that was one problem I had. My classroom management wasn't always the best. I'd have kids kind of taking advantage of me. So it's better for me to be a writer or work at a library, something more low-key for my personality. So that's, and you know, honestly, I didn't want to be a teacher. My grandpa was a teacher, and he told me I should go into it, and that's how I got into that vocation in the beginning. So that's why I'm not in it anymore.
Okay. Yeah, it's best to make your own decisions about your life. So tell me about the romantic interest in the story.
In the story, it's not like I set out to write a romance novel in the beginning. It's kind of a parody of romance novels, because I hate how they always try to sell, like, this romantic idea. So he's more of a modern person. He's not perfect, but he's a businessman. He owns a business. His parents wanted him to be a lawyer, which is based on what some people I know. And basically, it's just a story about people finding themselves, figuring out what they want to do. And he is romantic towards the end, but he doesn't really discover that until he grows up. It's kind of like a critique of modern-day Western life, like in the Western states. Like, things I've gone through. And, you know, just a critique of things that I've experienced. Mostly, so I'm still working on it. I'm not done yet. We'll see how it goes. But, you know, it's going good.
I look forward to hearing more about it. Maybe you can post some excerpts, even.
I might. I'm just leery to do that after I've had things copied. I might do that. I keep having things copied. You know, and it's kind of scary.
That's not good.
I've had a lot of it. Like, and it is very irritating as a writer to have to do those DMCA. I hate that so much, you know. But you have to do what you have to do to protect your writing. It's your intellectual property. You can't let it be stolen.
Right. Yeah. What was that? Was that a site in Turkey or Russia that had you copies.
Russia at first, but then I did another search, and the domain is registered in the Netherlands, so it's really weird. I don't know, it's like it was in Russian at first, but then I went and did another search, and the site is actually registered in the Netherlands. I think it might be a Turkish domain name that they purchased, but the people live in the Netherlands. It's just a very odd, peculiar site because it has a weird name to it. It's not even like a name for searching.
Yeah, I tried to look that up to see if it was a word in some language, and apparently not.
No, it's just really weird. And my experience, I've had like a couple of Chinese boys that stole my content, and then they would insert links to shoe ads. Like, I've had some really weird things, like jewelry hubs or websites like where I write an article about how to make jewelry, and they'll steal things and they'll put in shoe links, and I'm just like, this is interesting. It doesn't make any sense, like the way that they choose to do it. Like, you would think that they would at least take content and make it sensical, but to me it makes no sense. I can't explain it. It's just really weird.
Well, yeah, that's marketing, because the fact of the matter is I don't think that necessarily the best written material, you know, and the best arranged material is the material that ends up, you know, getting the most clicks. So I don't really know what they're thinking, or does that make any sense?
No, I know what you're saying, because I know there's some people that are really good at marketing. I don't think that they are. I think they're just taking anything from any site and putting it on their site in hopes that somebody's going to buy something from Amazon. Because I noticed they have links to Amazon on their website. Uh-huh. And they're copying different things. So it's peculiar, but I've seen a lot of that. Some people actually left hub pages because they were tired of people taking their content off the site.
Yeah. Right. Well, what do you think about the Panda update? Or did that make any dent in your situation?
It did a little bit for hub pages, to be honest with you. I did lose a lot of traffic. My other sites gathered more traffic. I started writing for eHow more again because I was making payout every month with AdSense, and then it diminished to where I wasn't making it every month anymore. And that was a little bit of extra income, and I can actually make a little bit more with eHow if I write for them monthly. Yeah, so yeah, I did make a dent, and to be honest with you, I don't think it's always the best sites that are getting ahead in my experience. I don't know what your experience is with Panda, but I've seen some things that are scraper sites, like that one site we were talking about, higher in the search engines.
Yes, I mean, I found all sorts of things that I thought were not timely. They were old, and they were mostly garbage, and they outranked other things. So, no, I don't think that the update really made things better for people who are searching.
I think there's a lot of people that have, this is just my opinion, they're insecure and they're jealous of anybody who writes and tries to market themselves or has a website. That's the impression I get, because there's a lot of hatred for people on hub pages and Speedo. And if you go to Reddit, which is a website I've decided I really do not like, they have entire forums just devoted to trashing anybody that writes their own website. And that's...
Yeah. Those Reddit people were really mean to me. I mean, I actually got a lot of traffic from them when I was new on Hub Pages, but they went and read about Bo, and all they wanted to do was say hateful things, and some of it was really nasty.
They think the Google update is. I don't think it is. I think there's a lot of people that are just mass blocking websites that might have good content on them because they have a grudge against a certain website. That's the impression I'm getting from the Panda update.
Well, yeah, there's a little bit of that, and there are just the very well-established sites, you know. So right now, if you're looking to purchase something, you'll see the department stores earlier than maybe an article that actually describes the product. So there's a lot of that. I noticed that you also do a lot of drawing and artwork and crafts. How does that work in with your writing? Is it separate, or do you feel like it's the same kind of creativity?
It actually works in pretty well. To be honest with you, I've written a lot of crafting articles, a lot of art articles. I've been writing for The Examiner for 2 years. I write on a lot of different websites. I'm a National Examiner. I used to write articles, like several articles per week for them. I stepped back a little bit from that when I started working on my own websites this year. But I was pretty active with them, and as a national examiner, people are always reading your articles, looking for crafting ideas. And I've had parents who came to me and said that articles I did on shirt painting inspired them to get their kids into trying a craft that they thought was too messy. And I explained it in a way that they've never thought of how they could organize it. And so I've gotten some good feedback, not as much as the entertainment aid examiner, but as a national examiner, I have got some traffic for my art. And I'm also on a couple other websites where I share my art. So I think it works in well. Plus, I've just always had a lot of interest. I've always been into drawing, art, writing. I was a history major in college. I've done a lot of different things. So it's just who I am.
Yeah, I think it's wonderful to be able to do all of them together and, you know, integrate all those different interests. But sometimes before the web was such a big thing, we had to do all those things separately, and we had different groups of people that we shared different things with, but now we can share it all.
That's true. And then especially I think it's really neat with Bo, like seeing him. That's so neat. That's something I never would have seen if it weren't for the internet. So I discover a lot of new things. I also saw another website with elephants that were painting pictures. There's so many things that I would never have discovered without the internet. I think it's really cool.
Yeah. I think it's a whole new world. It really is. Is there anything else that I haven't asked you, but you really want to talk about?
While we're writing, I just wanted to say I really like your site, how it's small and how you encourage people to write what they're interested in. And I think that's a good thing. A lot of sites are getting to the point where they're so large that they're not encouraging creativity anymore or differing opinions. So I just wanted to say I really appreciate your website and how you allow people to do that. So thank you for letting us write on your website.
Well, thank you for writing there. It would be kind of empty without people writing. So it works out both ways. But yeah, when I joined the Hub Pages, I appreciated the fact that they allowed different people to express different opinions. And even though I don't like necessarily what's been going on there now, I want to follow in their footsteps, and I don't want everybody to have the same opinion on my site. I'd like to see different opinions expressed, different styles. I think it's more interesting that way.
Plus, I think in the long run, people will respect your site more. And I'm not trying to get down on Hub Pages or other sites. I know a lot of them think that they're trying to help themselves in the search engines, but I just think they're discouraging a lot of writers and people are leaving.
Yeah, unfortunately, that's been the trend. But anyway, we're lucky that we were there when it was still a lot of fun and we got to meet each other and take all of that away. So. Okay, well, I think we have plenty of material here for me to work this out into a very nice interview. And so why don't we sign off, and I'll let you know when I have it all worked out.
All right, thank you, and have a good night.
Okay, you too. Bye-bye.
That's kind of cool. That was like the first one.
Yeah, and I was really inexperienced.
I thought you were pretty good. For being the first time, I thought it went really well.
Yeah, I thought it did. You know, I mean, that was the start of everything, and then we kept going.
I know, and the thing is, I feel like when I think about the writing thing, I don't really consider myself a writer anymore. I consider myself a blogger, but after I wrote that book, I felt like I didn't really feel like I could publish it, or I didn't feel like it was my vocation to be a writer after writing that. I love writing, but it changed my mind on that. And I decided I actually love blogging and video creation more.
Yeah, I think a lot of us are doing that now. Of course, I did publish my novels.
I mean, you are definitely a writer. You're a published writer for sure, but I'm not, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, but I mean, even I, you know, I used to blog a lot. I used to think that if I just blogged enough, people would buy my books. So I wrote the novels. And then after I wrote the novels, I wrote blog post after blog post after blog post and nobody read them. And and now I just do videos, you know?
You know, it's because of Panda, they kind of forced this. Okay. I know, like, CD Ford thought I was explaining cancel culture, but I wasn't. I was explaining Google Panda. It was where the big media corps didn't want the – it's not cancel culture per se. They just didn't want the small bloggers or the small websites to rank. They wanted mainstream – that's not – it's kind of cancel culture, but it's kind of not, if that makes any sense. I don't know.
They just wanted to centralize everything. So one
– yeah.
One can still write on the web and get paid for it, and I still do that.
Yeah.
But you do it, you're a contractor under somebody else, and they have the rules, and they get to edit what you write. If they don't like what you write, it has to be something different. So basically, the little guy lost his platform to just speak on his own.
Yeah, because of Google Panda. And I just want to express how much I loved when Hub Pages was earning money for us and we could write about any topic we wanted. And then we could have our own website. And in the beginning, they were actually ranking, like in 2008, you could make a side income doing this. And Google and mainstream media sites were just so greedy that they didn't want regular people doing that. That's my opinion on that. And because I remember I lived through it and it was just a creative. I love making videos, but I could express myself more creatively through the writing, but I don't do that anymore because I don't really earn any money doing it anymore.
Exactly. I still have pub wages. You know, a lot of people had sites and those sites are completely defunct, but I still have pub wages. I still have Historia Obscura, but not a lot goes on there right now.
Yeah, well, and you know, on Hub Pages, once a year, I earn like $50. But back in the day, I could earn several hundred dollars a month. It was a good side income. That's what I'm trying to tell people. You could make money doing it. And I think that's why they took it away, because people were making a living doing this. And then I feel like, oh, it's intimidation, because it became competition for the big media corps. Like, oh, you mean the little guy that might have some knowledge about something? Well, here's an example. Somebody wrote a blog. I know blogs aren't getting as much traction nowadays, but it wasn't even historically accurate. The lady said that women wore red chemises in the Middle Ages because if they had their cycle, it wouldn't show up, and that they used cotton, which wasn't true. They used linen. And then a lady that was an expert on medieval attire said, this isn't even accurate. And the person was like, but I have my degree in library science. And she's like, but you don't have your degree in history. It wasn't accurately researched. So I feel like they took away the ability of people who were passionate and had knowledge about something to put out a good piece of research. Because now, you know what I see on, like, if you do see a news article, it's just, it's spammy kind of stuff. There's a lot of spammy ads. Have you noticed that?
Yeah. Yes, I have. Nobody reads mainstream media anymore.
No, they don't. Well, they try to make me, like, okay, with Bing, because I, for some reason, I don't have an Apple computer. So if you have an IBM type computer, Bing is like, they try to default that to your main search engine, which I don't want it to be. And then all these articles about Harry and Meghan always show up. And I'm like, oh my gosh, please spare me.
Yeah. No, the thing is that it was all kind of preparation for what happened in 2020, where they wanted to silence even doctors who didn't agree with the mainstream. So if they didn't agree with what the CDC was saying, they didn't want those people to be heard.
Yeah. And also, too, like, I'm wondering about things like, okay, supposedly everybody's like, oh, but the government will always take care of you. But do you know what happened recently up in the mountains? Like, they're always like, we do a good job. We do a good job. But do you know what happened? Do you know what's still happening up there right now with all the snow?
Are they all still snowed in, or did they
get out? There's many streets that they didn't plow. And then they were trying to defend themselves on the news saying, oh, we did a good job. We handled it correctly. No, you did not. Like, not that I think, okay, this is the thing that kind of irritates me about this, is open the road and let a private plow company come in. And I was trying to explain that to people who live up there. If you could just have some private plow companies come in and plow out those roads, I think they could do a better job than Caltrans could, because they have done nothing. They've done absolutely nothing.
Should I share your video of the snow up there?
If you want to, yeah, sure. I just feel passionate about that right now. I'm sorry not to go off.
Yeah.
I'm just like, no, my gosh.
not off topic at all. So while I show it, you can explain what we're seeing, okay?
Okay. So this is the beginning of the snowstorm. They got about 8 to 9 feet of snow. There's never that much snow. It's usually like 3 feet on a big snow. So I kept, the cat is like, he's sinking in the snow. The snow is as high as the car. Do you see that? Do you see how it's
as high? Wow.
And look at this. Like, this is the second day of the snow. Like, it's just, it's piling up, and they would try and plow some of it. And this, I think this is the second day actually, but more and more kept coming. Like, the sun came out for a while, but like snow went on top of the snow. Like they would, some people would try and plow a little bit, but then it would just bury. Like you can't, that is like almost 4 feet high at that point, like across the street. It's never been that high. We don't get that much snow up in those mountains. That's ridiculous. Like even I think in 1949, it did not snow that much. And it kept going. It kept going. So the cat's like really bewildered. He's like, oh, I can't go outside. Look at all the snow. Like, and then he's on top, almost near the roof, where the icicle is. And that's 9 feet high, almost. Like, everybody was really snowed in, and they didn't believe us. But yes, they are. Like, he's trying to climb up. Like, there's all this snow.
So tell us the name of the cat. Is it your mother's cat?
Yeah, his name is Chevy the cat, because my mom found him in my dad's old Chevy truck. And a mom had abandoned them, and he was one of the kittens. But you know, he's a great cat. He's a fun little cat. So, but he doesn't know what to think about like 8-9 feet of snow.
Right. Yeah.
But they didn't handle it right, because right now people are like, "Well, why? Like, why are you guys still snowed in?" Because they didn't plow the roads. And I don't know, let some private plow companies come in up there to plow, but they were like cordoning off the roads, saying only certain people can go through and we have to manage who comes through. Well, I don't think they're managing it at all. My opinion, you know, what are they doing? Nothing.
Yeah. Yeah.
But they defended themselves. Like, we handle it the best. I don't know. And then we question, like, how did all this, like, we've never had a snowstorm like this. This, I mean, I don't want to be conspiracy theorist, but that's interesting that this happened like a couple weeks after all these things were flying overhead. And we were talking about that too.
Wow.
That's what we've been thinking. Like, what is going on? Okay. So there's all these things in the sky, like they might be from China. Sometimes they're saying they don't know where they're from. And then we have all this freak weather, you know, these are just thoughts that we're thinking about. You know, I'm not trying to say, oh, this is exactly what happened, but we don't get weather like that up there.
You know, yeah.
It's
certainly doesn't make sense in terms of the theory of global warming, does it?
Well, not really. I don't see, you can't really say, but then they're going to say, like, what they're going to say is, oh, but, you know, the weather can be erratic, but the weather climates always change. Climates continuously change, you know?
Yeah.
So it kind of does blow that out the window, but it's interesting. I don't know. It's very weird. It's very strange. You can't, I don't know. Like, my only thought was, because we know that they can do jet streams to control the weather, like when there's a sporting event, and keep bad weather away. You know about that, right?
I've heard about it. Yeah.
Yeah. So we don't know for sure, but my theory is, did they do that so they could have more water, say, oh, we got more precipitation this year. That was my only other theory. I don't know. It's just a thought that popped in my head. I don't know for sure.
Yeah, well, anything's possible. After all, you know, they told us we were wrong to think that COVID-19 came from a lab leak, but it did.
Yeah, no, that's true. That's true. It did not start in a wet market, and they were researching it. Like, that wasn't made up. They were literally doing research on that. I know they say that's not true, but it didn't start in a wet market.
Yeah, no, we now know. Now the authorities have you know, recanted. So we now know that even the federal government knows that it came from the lab, and the lab was funded, you know, by our government.
Yeah, this is true. Well, I think all the major governments know that they're all kind of working on something. You know, it's kind of like the Democrats and the Republicans that say, oh, like, we hate each other, but behind closed doors, they don't really hate each other. I think the elites all kind of coalesce when they know there's this vested interest in something for themselves, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know why you'd want to do that. I think it was a really horrible, like, why you would have put it. I don't know the theories behind these things. It's just weird. Like, why is there all this snow all of a sudden? But I don't want to be like a conspiracy theorist. I just know that doesn't happen. And I know they're going to say, but sometimes there's freak snowstorms, but not like this.
Yeah. Williams seems to have something to say.
They don't really hate each other, William. You might think that they hate each other and they are going to pretend that way on the media, but no, they got together to in 1992 to vote for a pay raise. Then they were all able to get together. They just hate each other when it's divide and conquer politics. And that's as old as the world is round. You know?
Okay. I agree. So, you know, right now what's happening, another thing is that AI is taking over the jobs of artists, the jobs of writers. Pretty soon, all those articles that we used to write.
I've heard about this. Yes.
And also art. And some artists are actually suing because they believe that the AI was copying their style and their way of doing art. So all of that is interesting. But you know what? 3 years ago, I started trying to work on my art. At the time, I thought I was going to get better, you know, improve my art to the point where I could do book covers. And I know I'm not the only person who thought this. Jean Laura was thinking the same thing. So she started to take art lessons and worked on her art. And now we all hear that, you know, it's not necessary. You can have an AI thing do better for you.
Yeah.
But I can't help but still want to draw. And today I painted you.
I like it.
In my sketchbook, it's a watercolor.
It's pretty. I think you really captured the essence of like how I looked in that video, you know?
Thank you. That's what I was looking at. I just did a still, you know, the publicity shot for, and then I looked at that. Would you like to see a sped up version of how I painted
that? Yeah, for sure. I would love to see that.
Okay. We can still talk because I didn't put any music on it.
Oh, that's so cool. You really got the, like, my face, my mouth shape. It really does look like my lips. I was going to say that was striking to me.
Yeah. I mean, a couple of times I had to kind of wipe it because I, you know, with watercolor, you get too much paint on it. And so
it runs.
I had to start again, you know, but I had a good idea of how I wanted to do it. It's just sometimes I don't control, you know, the movement of the water.
Well, I think you did pretty good because water paint is a hard medium to control. It has a mind of its own, really.
Oh, Angela likes it.
It's nice. Yeah, I think you really captured like my face in that video. See, so I like it. And I was wearing lipstick at that time. Like, I don't really wear lipstick anymore, but I feel like you kind of got that. And then my more rectangular glasses, I have more of the cat eye ones now. And my facial expressions, I look younger. Like, I think you captured the essence of a younger Julia.
Well, thank you. I thought that your look was quite striking. You know, I hadn't looked at it in quite a long time, but you know, it was actually a beautiful picture of you. I don't mean my painting, but you know the.
Well, I mean, I do like the painting though, but I guess it is kind of a beautiful picture of me as well. I mean, I do think I'm very presentable on camera. That I do know.
Oh, yes. Definitely.
But I love you are a character painter, and I don't think AI can completely replace that because AI might replicate certain things and look like a painting. But I still think there are people that want records. There's people that want old-fashioned books. I still believe there are people that want paintings created by people and they want to paint themselves. I think there's always going to be people that want these tactile arts, you know? I don't think AI can replace that completely. You see what I'm saying?
Well, I think right now the attraction to those channels where people paint and show how they're painting, it's almost like a performance art. Like nobody's interested in the ultimate painting that we make because you could get a better one from AI, but they're still interested in, but how do I do this? You know, if they want to do it.
Yeah, I think people enjoy, like I've noticed people enjoy watching your videos on your art channel. It's like just see it come to life. And I love the description about like why you paint the other day. I thought that was a lot of fun, you know?
Yeah, well, I enjoy doing that. Of course it is just for fun, but it doesn't feel like it's just for fun. It feels like a lot more profound, although it's hard to explain.
It is more profound. You know how some people are all about meditation, and I've kind of like, I don't want to get down on meditation, but I think it's so overrated because I think when you find something where you are in the zone, that's real meditation instead of this faux, like, oh my gosh, I must meditate. I must go listen to this sort of deep breathing. I just never could get on board with that. I think real meditation is this. Do you like painting or drawing, or do you get in a zone doing that? That to me is real meditation. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. It's certainly true. When I'm doing that, then I'm not thinking about myself. I'm thinking about what I'm doing and I become part of what I'm doing.
Yeah. And you feel like relaxed and you enjoy doing it and you keep wanting to do that because you get like this kind of energy high off of it. Right.
Exactly. Exactly.
All the things that they said meditation did, and the people would be like, you should try meditation, Julia. But I didn't like meditation because you have to listen to this like chanting or tape or people saying things. And I just never got on board with that. But sometimes when I really get into art, that's when I feel those things that the people say they feel when they listen to the meditative chants. Not that I'm trying to like poo-poo it. It's just that's not for me. I think art is more meditative, my opinion.
Yeah. So did you want to share some of your art? After all, it's an interview of you.
I mean, do you want me to like take things off the wall and show you? Is that kind of what you're thinking?
Whatever you would like to do.
I mean, I can do that. Like I haven't done that for a while. So I have some things nearby. Okay. So I have this one. This is Irina the cat.
Aw. Yeah.
So she's coming out of the woods. I thought that was kind of fun. I created this one with oil paint. Is that easier to see it? I don't know.
Hold on. Yeah. Hold on. Could you put it up higher? Yeah. Good. Yes. Very nice. Very nice.
This was a painting that I really loved. I just created Irina based. She never came out of the woods. This was based on a photograph I took on a hike as a child, the background. But Irina is based on a photograph I took of her that day in 2014. So
I love the way the road sort of winds back. And it makes a wonderful background for her.
Yeah, there's actually a road like this on the Pinnacles when you're doing the hiking trail that winds around like that. And these trees are based on some trees in a photo that I took when I was 8. I had an eye for photography when I was 8. I don't know. I've just always had that thing like, okay, when I was 9 years old, I got up when we went hiking one morning up in Death Valley. And I went and took pictures of like the hills with my silly little camera, but I still have the pictures. I don't have them with me, but here's another one. This is kind of an unusual one, I think. I don't know if it's too reflective. Can you see it?
Yeah, I can see it. Yeah.
Yes. So this is supposed to be like Mount Baldy, and it's supposed to be the view from my parents' house. So that was oil paint. I probably should have put it behind glass, though. I'm afraid it's stuck now. So.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not customary to frame oil paint.
I shouldn't have done that, but I'm afraid if I take it out, it's going to ruin it. That's one problem I'm kind of worried about.
We have something that Angela agreed with you. She would rather have something handmade, original, not from a machine.
Nice. I agree, Angela, because I think, you know, AI has a time and place, but I still believe there's people that want handmade items. Well, here's the one thing. We're always talking about indigenous art. I don't think AI can replicate that. And if people are against the cultural appropriation, you better not. You better be careful. So AI might be problematic, like for people that really think of the drew. So this is a giraffe that I drew, and this is colored pencil Prisma. Oh, 2011. I thought it was kind of fun.
I love it.
Can you see it, or is it?
Yeah. So is the giraffe eating something, or what is that?
There's like a bush. It's just next to him. He could be eating it. He's not eating it in the.
Okay. Drawing. Okay.
Yeah. So I have other things. I'm just going to take stuff off that I could show you. If you want me to show you a few more things, I have this little colored marigolds.
Maybe they're all. Oh, that's beautiful.
I know, this one's kind of fun. So I drew this in 2011. So it's just marigolds in my backyard.
Did you ever make a greeting card or something with that illustration?
I did on Zazzle. Remember, I used to do a lot of stuff on Zazzle. It was all on there. But the thing about Zazzle is a lot of the things I created were de-indexed, and you have to go back in and bring them back to life, which I'm like, ugh. But I did on Zazzle. Here's another one. It's just kind of it's a cat. It's just a cat that I created. This was actually acrylic. Sitting next to
it. Yeah, and the flower. Tell me about the flower.
Oh, it's a morning glory. So I love morning glories, and I have them. I used to have some in my little patio. So it was more just about the morning glory than the cat. It was kind of, let's see what else I have. I have some other ones that are kind of unusual that I don't know if I've shown you before. There's this one. It's an oil painting. It's supposed to be the boulders out at the pinnacles, but the colors are kind of surreal, I think. I thought that they were realistic at the time, but I guess it's kind of surreal because I don't think, you know.
Yeah, that is actually very similar to the painting style that Sandy Hester does that I told you about, that I follow her. So it's very nice. I can't remember exactly what she calls her style, but that looks like it.
Kind of reminiscent of it. I mean, this was a fun painting. The thing that kind of annoyed me is I was doing a blog thing, A to Z challenge, and I was sharing my artwork, and some people were just being real snobby about it. They're like, well, that you could improve. And I'm like, I'm happy with my artwork. And they were telling me there's a book called How to Draw on the Right Side of Your Brain, which I don't like. I tried that book. I didn't like it. But it's supposed to make you a better artist. I like my art. I can improve.
Well, you know that recently when I posted a drawing that I did, people said, well, I don't want to be rude, but you could really study anatomy and really improve that.
I just think that's not fair or right or accurate, right? You made a video. What did you say in your video about it?
Well, what I said is that while studying anatomy might be very helpful for many things, like for a physician, when you're actually trying to caricature someone, it doesn't help.
No, not at all. So this was just a palm tree. It's kind of hard to see, but it's like acrylic, I believe, and it's behind plastic. But yeah.
Is it in the water?
Yeah, it's supposed to be the beach behind it.
Oh, yeah. Nice.
Yeah, it's kind of fun. And then another one that I did was just a colored pencil. It's the sunset. I'm sorry that these are all reflective. I didn't mean. And it's near my house. Actually, it's the view of Mount Baldy in the distance. But we have sunsets like that. So I just used colored pencils. And I was afraid it was going to fade. But this time around, the prisms don't seem to be fading. I think it was cheaper ones I did. But now I would only use, I want to use paint. So I've changed. I have another one. This is really old, actually, 2002. This was an owl that I painted.
Oh, wow.
I think it's bait. I saw a picture in a magazine, or I think it might have been a painting. So I'm not, I kind of did it myself, but this one was just inspired. But I did all my own painting of it. I created it.
Yeah, but it was kind of based on.
Yeah. But it was kind of based on an image. So, but I made it my own, if that makes any sense. That was back when I was kind of learning how I was going to do my art. And then I have some other things too that are older, a really old one that actually got me started with wanting to paint tropical sunsets. I can stop after this. this could be the last one I show, but it's a kind of a big one. It's a painting of a sunset, like in Hawaii. So that's when I started getting into doing like the silhouette.
Yeah, it is. That's what makes me think of it. And it looks like the focus is on the trees, and then the background, the mountain in the background, is kind of blurry on purpose, like you didn't focus on it.
Yeah, it could be a mountain. At the time, I thought it was the sky, but you're right. It looks like it could be a mountain, too. I never thought about that. It's a good point.
Yeah. And it seems sort of out of focus on purpose, you know, to focus on the trees. So I like that.
That's actually a really cool observation. I was trying to paint the sky, but you're right. It looks like it could be a mountain. I never thought about that. This was the first time I painted on canvas because I found a canvas. I think I was like 23. I was visiting my parents and I found this canvas and I'm like, why does my dad have a canvas? And my mom's like, I don't know why. And I asked him, he's like, I don't know. Somebody gave it to me. I'm like, okay, I'm going to paint on it. So I noticed it had two holes on it. So I repaired it with tape. And that's when I started painting a lot on canvases. But then I went to other mediums after that. Sometimes paper, sometimes canvas board. Sometimes I think, honestly, now I just want to paint more than, like, I thought I loved colored pencils, but I feel like paintings last longer, you know?
Yeah, so I went from painting on canvas and canvas board mm-hmm. with acrylics to now I do, I did recently do a canvas board of my daughter. I just recently did that. But most, you know, I have so many paintings and I couldn't possibly put them all up on the wall. So I have found that I can do these watercolors like the one I did of you, and these really small, you know, this is how big the sketchbook is. So it opens up like this and I get this much space to paint in, and then I can put it in a drawer or something and store it, and it doesn't take a lot of space.
That's smart. I think I really like that. So yeah, that's some of my art. I don't know. Maybe you haven't seen all that art yet. So did you see all those pieces before? I think maybe in the past.
Not all of them. No, not all of them.
I definitely have more art, but I think I showed you some things I haven't showed you yet. So I thought that was kind of fun.
Yeah. No, it was. And Angela says capturing the essence of a person or scenery is more giving the painting depth than making sure everything looks exact, if that makes sense. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, that's a good point. So I think there was some other videos you wanted to share, like you had something else we were gonna share in the lineup, I thought.
Let's see, we already shared how Bo first met you
mm-hmm.
and we shared how I interviewed you the very first time.
Okay.
And I shared how I painted you, and we shared the the snow in the mountains.
Mm-hmm.
So I did want to say thank you to my the people who are members on my channel. Would you like to see the funny thing that I made to thank them?
Yes, of course.
Okay.
Aw. That's fun.
Yeah. It's funny. I thought, oh, you know what? There was a sound that went with it. Let me do it again. I thought something was weird about it, but the sound was silenced. So let me. It's silencing itself.
That's weird. Maybe it's, but sometimes it doesn't do that. StreamYard's kind of not.
Let me try again.
Plays the sound, sometimes it doesn't.
Let's try one more time. There you go.
Oh, I hear it. It's like a firecracker. Oh.
Okay.
Is that your chickens?
No, it was actually a sound on my editing thing, but it could have been my chickens. I'm getting more chicks soon, and I'm hoping that we can get a guard dog so that, you know, that the fox and the other predators don't get them. But
so will the guard dog live inside with your other dogs at night, or is he going to have his own?
No, he's going to have to think he's a chicken or a duck.
Oh, that's interesting.
So he won't be lonely. He'll be living with them.
Okay. Nice.
And then when they go for a walk, he'll be escorting them.
How do you find this kind of dog? Are they dogs trained to do this, or how do they do that?
Well, I want to get a puppy, so I want to raise it with the chickens and the ducks. So.
Oh, I see. So you're going to be training him from scratch. Okay.
Yeah, but it has to be a good breed. So I was thinking maybe a border collie. I'm not sure.
I mean, there has to be I would think there's got to be a type of dog that does this. Like, I've never looked into it, but I would imagine, right?
Right. Yeah. I was actually thinking of some pit bull puppies that I could have adopted one of them. But I was told that even though pit bulls are wonderful with the families and with the animals that belong to the family, they're such, you know, they don't like strangers, and they wouldn't necessarily be nice to the strangers' animals. So I guess that would not be right.
Yeah, and also too, like, pit bulls, they're not as violent as people are always saying they're violent, which isn't fair, because actually Labradors have attacked more than pit bulls have. That's not fair.
Oh, I know that. I know that. And I know they're wonderful family dogs.
But what I was gonna say, sometimes they don't like small animals, like, so you have to, it's hard. Yeah. Yeah, so
right. You have to find a dog that is right for that. And you see, because my poultry do wander, they're allowed to go free. The dog would also have to be allowed to go free. So it has to be a dog that won't bother the neighbor's animals.
Yes. That's what I was trying to convey, that I had a dog that was half pit bull and half Siberian Husky, and he was a very sweet dog, but he could not be around chickens. He wasn't.
Yeah, I wouldn't think so. No.
No. He was Buster the dog. He had a big head, but yeah, he was a nice dog, but he couldn't be around chickens. I could tell you that. He'd think.
Yeah. Yes. And my two dogs that I have right now could not be around chickens, and that's why they're not. But I need something to guard them. And I think if I get a puppy and the puppy bonds with the chickens and the ducks, it wouldn't be cruel to the dog either. You know,
I think they would all think that they were family and they'd get along and he'd want to protect them.
Yes, that's what I would want.
There's no pit bull versus chimpanzee, William. That doesn't make any sense. That's just silly.
William has been... he has an overactive imagination. He's been trying to make all sorts of suggestions to everyone in my family.
I think it must be fun. It's just his imagination's off. Anyway, it's just funny, I guess. I did want to say one more thing about hub pages that I feel like I miss, not necessarily hub pages, but I miss that we could just have a blog and just write about whatever we want, and that we can't make money anymore, and that Google took that away. I think that was horrible, because why did Google, like, why did we let one entity control the internet? You know, it was a free market. There were people that wanted to advertise on those websites that people ran. So for me, Google is, I don't want necessarily the government to break it up, but I feel like the government kind of enabled Google to do what they did. You know, it's kind of the other way around.
Well, I don't know exactly how Google got the monopoly that it did. I still use DuckDuckGo myself.
Yes. I mean, there are other alternatives, but the problem is, well, Bing is kind of becoming the same way now. They're forcing you. Like, I don't know if you've noticed, but if you have any kind of Dell computer, or anytime you set up the computer, unless you have to reset what your internet browser is going to be.
No, I always do that. So I always. No.
But a lot of people don't know anything.
I always put DuckDuckGo, but I'm not saying that I don't think they're controlled by the same people, you know, it's just the best I can do.
Yeah, it's the best you can do, but I feel like at least, I mean, I have nothing against Google or Bing, but But I just don't like that they took away the free market that allowed competition, you know?
Well, I'm really confused about what's happening with the AI, the ChatGPT. I'm confused about why it's free, for one thing. What are they planning? Because surely they're not making any money by giving that away for free, are they?
No, they're not. But the thing about, okay, that's not the one that controls the AI on TikTok, but the TikTok AI, it's not as sophisticated, but obviously it's the Chinese government that controls that. So it's kind of weird. It's very strange. Like the things that it like produces, it produces some very strange art. It's not really high grade, like the ChatGPT one, but I'm like, this is weird.
Yeah, well, I don't really want to be involved in TikTok for that reason.
No. Yeah, I know a lot of people have taken a stance against TikTok, and I still post on there, but it doesn't really do anything. And I found out that their top like earners don't really even make that much money. YouTube does a better job at compensating creators, so.
Yeah, I wanted to tell you, Julia, all these people keep sending me emails about how they can help me make a lot more money off my videos and stuff like that. What I was thinking is maybe I should invite all of them, not just one of them, but all of them for an interview with us, the two of us, and we can ask them what they are offering, because I just feel that I need to understand what these offers really are before I accept any of them.
I know what these offers are because I looked into it and I already knew what it was. Basically, what they're going to do for you is like, you know, TubeBuddy or any of these like tube sites where it teaches you what keywords, like it's basically.
No, it's not that. It's more like they want to pay me royalties by selling some of my videos to other outlets or something like that.
Oh, one of those things where you join the network. Is that more what you're talking about? Like you join a network of creators. Is that what you were talking about? Or,
well, it's not that either. So I have to, you know, each one of them offers something different.
Okay. You're getting different offers than what I got. Then I didn't get anything like this. That's interesting.
Yeah. So some of them sound like they want to be managers and get a percentage. Some of them sound like they're going to sell my stuff to somebody else and I'll get royalties. But all, you know, I'm not going to commit to one of them without understanding how it stacks up against another one, you know. So I just thought maybe we should invite them all to be interviewed.
I mean,
to explain what it is that they're offering in very clear terms, and then we can cross-examine them.
I mean, that's a good idea. I did get offered to join one of those networks where you gave a percentage of your earnings, but I decided not to do that because all the really big YouTubers said that they regretted joining those sites years ago and it didn't really help them out. And I think the only time it was a benefit to someone was if they were making like controversial videos that were kind of inflaming people, that because they were part of that network, it was harder to get the videos taken down.
Well, yeah, I'm not talking about any of that. I'm talking about, I do know that the really big YouTubers have managers.
Well, they have managers for sure, but I'm not sure it's exactly what these people are offering. Are these people legitimate? They sound more just like...
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying. Why don't we interview them?
I mean, you can definitely interview them, but I'm a little skeptical of who they are, but...
Yeah, so... As my co-host, you can be as skeptical as you like and ask them as many skeptical questions. That's what I'm saying.
They're willing to come on, but I don't think they will. I think they're the kind of people that just want you to sign up. And I'm going to be honest. I think that they're fraudulent.
I understand what you've just said. But do you understand what I'm saying? I'm saying it would be prime entertainment.
It would be great entertainment. I'm not against your doing that. Would they accept to come on? I'm just curious. I'll be excited if you can get them to come on.
Okay, and you're willing to be co-host when we do this, right?
Yeah, I would. I would for sure. I just I'm just not getting the offers that you're getting. I think because your channel's growing, you're getting some more offers that I'm not.
Yeah, but I still don't know if any of them are any good. You know, like for instance, the the HelloFresh. It wasn't really HelloFresh. It was a Stream Element. And once I was paid, there was also a fee on what I was paid. So it was interesting.
Okay, that's weird. I don't know. That's weird. And then I kind of looked into HelloFresh, and some people did get the free meal kits, but then it's kind of, okay, I want to elaborate on that. Like, they said at first it seemed like a good deal because they might get a free meal, but then it became almost like a scam because they were trying to get them into like this thing where they had to keep paying for it.
Yeah, no, yeah. I understood that part. And of course, anytime I'm given an offer where it's free the first time, but then it's hard to get out of it, I never take the free thing in the first place.
Yeah. And I never even, okay, I got something that was similar and it wasn't even free. I signed up for one of those produce boxes that you probably remember when I did a few videos on those, right?
Yeah.
So it became almost impossible to cancel the produce box.
Yeah. No, I never go for any deal that's like that. I could have done that, but you know, it would be different if they actually sent something free without any obligation. So for instance, the Bully Bite, you know, that was free. I have no obligation to buy Bully Bites. They just sent it, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I did have some free deals. Like I had a spin brush. I wouldn't buy it personally, but it came free and I reviewed it. And then the Dossier perfume, that was free. But you know, I kind of like the Dossier perfume. I just don't think I'd ever buy it. It's expensive. Honest. That's my honest opinion.
Right. Well, I don't mind if we are given products that are very expensive, like a new computer, a new camera, a new microphone. All of these things would be nice. So eventually, maybe that will happen.
Yeah, I mean, also too, another type of advertising I've been seeing is where people are advertising for like Squarespace or other like productivity tools, like. And it seems like they're just like doing a little blurb about it and they don't really have to. It's not even a product they're being sent. They're just like kind of, it's a ad during the video. Have you been seeing those lately too on some of the videos?
Yeah. They just offer you a deal with a percentage. It's the same thing as my HelloFresh thing that I offer.
Same
thing. Yeah, it was exactly the same.
Yeah. So I don't think that's even, well, I will be interested if you want to get those people to come on. Yeah, definitely. I would love to ask some questions.
Okay, well, then I might invite them for April when you're on.
Okay.
Because I don't want to be alone doing that.
No, we need some to help. Two people, yeah, for sure. Like to Kate. I mean, if Kate, does Kate want to join in and ask some questions too? That'd be kind of fun.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it would be fun even if it turns out it's all a scam.
Yeah, I mean, you know, honestly, my sister kind of did that. You know those scam Microsoft rewards where they're trying to scam people into like taking your computer hostage? Have you heard about that?
Yeah. I mean,
so anyway, they kept calling us, okay, a few years ago. And I'm like, oh, gosh, Kara, just hang up on them. She goes, no. She goes, I'm tired of them like scamming people, so I'm going to get them back. So she started calling them. And like, all sorts of silly things to them. And she was saying that, like, she was a tree. She was just saying all sorts of absurd things to them. She goes, I'm keeping them from scamming people today. This is hilarious. And they finally blocked her, so she couldn't do it anymore. But I thought that was pretty funny.
Oh, by the way, didn't you want to say happy birthday to your sister?
Oh, yeah, I do want to say happy birthday to her. She's, yeah, it's her birthday. So I'm excited for her. And I think that's great.
Okay. Good. Yeah.
My mom made her a very special cake. I guess it has sprinkles on the inside. It's a vanilla cake with white frosting. So I thought, oh, that sounds pretty.
It sounds very nice. It's very nice. Yeah. So, Julia, what about your hopes and dreams for the future? So we saw what you were working on back in 2011. And what you were, you know, what your hopes were at that time. What are you working on now? And what are you seeing, you know, 11 years from now?
Okay, 11 years from now, this is what I want. And I feel like I was just so like dreamy in that interview. I was like, oh, I'm going to be a writer, but I changed my mind about that. And I think YouTube's what changed my mind about that, really. I want to continue to grow my YouTube channel. I want to be a YouTube creator. I am, But I just want my, not the hair channel, because I'm kind of bored with that channel right now. I want my first channel to grow. I want to get back into doing more art. And I think one mistake that I haven't been following up on is I need to do more how-to art, like videos. Those actually perform well. I don't know why I don't do more of them. I should do more of that. I like reviewing products too. I want to keep just posting. And my goal is, you know, outside of work, I want to be a YouTuber. I want to be like a well-known YouTuber, and I want my channel. And I feel like, I just feel like my channel should be bigger at this point. Honestly, that's my honest truth.
Well, yeah, I think we all feel that way. You know, growth has been slow, and but you know, it continues at its own pace. Some people want to know what's up with Bo. Well, Bo is asleep. You see, I've always been able to talk to Julia without Bo in the evening. If I talk to her in the daytime, that's when Bo is involved. And that's what you saw in our introductory video.
Yeah. So I'm not saying that I don't ever consider myself a writer again. Sometimes I love to write an email, or I love to write a blog post, even though people don't really read those anymore. Or I just like to write something down. But I kind of shifted away from thinking I was going to be a published author. Like, Aya has written some wonderful novels, but personally, when I wrote that novel, it was just kind of comical in a way, because my sister read it and she said it was really boring. And I just don't think it was that entertaining, you know, to the general public. So I don't see myself as a writer anymore. I see myself as somebody who enjoys being a creative, who wants to express themselves creatively through this outlet. But honestly, I do want it to become more lucrative. That's my goal. You know, I'm going to be honest with you. I want it to be more lucrative.
Okay. All right. That's a perfectly valid goal. You know, I think we can grow our channels. By the way, there are links in the description to Julia's two channels. One is about hair and the other is California Mountain Art and Life,
which at the time, yeah, it was like I grew up in the mountains, but I don't even feel connected to that. You see, a lot of things have changed in the last 10 years of my life, you know.
Yeah, so are you going to change the channel name, or are you going to keep that?
I thought about that. I thought about changing it, but then I thought, are people going to get confused if I change yet another channel name, because I just changed one? So the only reason I kind of I'm going to hesitate towards not completely changing is when I started that channel, I used to go up to the San Bernardino Mountains a lot. I used to visit my parents all the time. I was always up there. I just don't go up there anymore, really. So that's why I just feel like more displaced. Like, I used to feel like I was a mountain girl, and I'm a woman now, and I'm not saying I'm not like a city woman. I guess like we're suburban. I just don't feel like I'm that same person anymore. Does that make any sense? Because I don't live there. If I lived there, I could say that I was this person, but I don't think I'd want to shovel through 9 feet of snow in that kind of mountain environment. Yeah, honestly, it's a little, it's not even rugged. Like, there's just too many extremes in weather. Like, they have heat, snow. So I'm thinking about changing the channel, but I just don't know if that's going to make my audience angry if I change yet another channel name, you know?
I have no idea. Maybe we should ask the people in chat. What do you guys think? So what would you change it to? Tell them the original name, and then tell them what you are thinking of changing it to.
See, that's the thing. I don't have a concrete name for it yet. I was thinking, because my TikTok is Julia Vlogs now, but it's not really a vlogging channel. It's more like cooking and art. So I guess I'm keeping the name because I don't really have a good name to change it to. Now, Julia's Hair Journey was a good name, because for a long time I was like, oh, I wear my hair down in a braid, so always wearing my long hair down. That kind of made sense. But after a while, I was wearing it up a lot, so it didn't really make sense. And people were like, but you don't wear your hair down. And I always say loose. And I was always kind of like having this dichotomy. But when I changed my channel name, I think that's part of the reason I lost a lot of earnings, because people got mad. First off, I cut my hair short. And also, I don't know, but my hair wasn't as long anymore. So how could I keep that name? So I don't know. It just kind of, it changed the whole traffic for my channel, because it was really growing, not growing as much as it had been, but it really plummeted this last year to almost nothing. It's like, okay, I have all those subscribers, but very few people actually watch it. I get more views actually on my old channel now, but I like that, honestly, Aya, because the content on my old channel, California Art and Mountain Life, it's more entertaining. Like, I can cook, I can talk, I can do like reviews. Like, I need to get back into doing art. It's just for me, like, I need to have that time that I set aside to do it, you know?
Yeah. So, and of course, everybody says the Beau is the coolest chimp in the city. Well, he's not in the city.
He doesn't live in the city. They say this is a city, but it's more suburban. We're not LA. Like, a city's like LA. It's like big, millions of people, high-rise buildings. That's what a city is. I don't even think this is a city because, like, no. Like, you have some roads that don't have lights on them. And, like, it's a hot, it's weird. It's not, they're forcing us to grow up, but it's not very coherent, like, into a city, but it's not structured.
But you have a train now. I see that your train videos are getting a lot of traffic.
People like the train, but people are train gawkers. Like, people, like, I get a lot of traffic from around the world, actually. People love to watch trains. I mean, I find them interesting, but there are people that flew here to, like, ride on that train. And I said, oh, I'm going to try and ride the train, but I still haven't ridden on the train yet. Like, because you have to put time aside, and it doesn't go near my house. You have to go, like, 5 miles down the road to catch it, or near my work. And it runs at times that are just inconvenient. So I haven't rode it yet. But people love the train. I didn't know, but there's like train, like, aficionados, like, they will travel the world, or they just look online to watch trains. They love them.
Yeah.
So yeah, those do get a lot of views. Honestly, I need to make another train short, but I stopped going. Like, I was going to Starbucks a few days and I would always see the train. So I was using that as an excuse, and I stopped doing that. So I haven't. At night, sometimes I see the train, but it runs at very strange times. But anyway, yeah, that's probably what my aspirations are right now, to grow my channel.
Okay, well, those are perfectly good, but I hope that we can also continue to work together.
I want us to work together. It's just, you were asking me, like, for my channel.
Yeah.
Like, honestly, I do love co-hosting with you. I do love it. Sometimes I get kind of burned out just because my schedule is kind of weird.
I know. You have a life. You have a life. But anytime that you can co-host, I'm always happy to have you on.
Well, I'm making the commitment to wanting to do it again. Like, once you have a free schedule, because I know you have a lot of guests right now. But, like,
yeah, Mark is already booked, but I have you down for all of April to co-host. Now, we might have guests, but you will be my main co-host.
That was the thing. Like, I always thought thumbs up was a good thing, but did you hear now that younger people think thumbs up is provocative?
Oh, really? Is it suddenly a white symbol or something?
It's not even that. It's just Gen X. I didn't know that. And there's even young guys that I know that do thumbs up. They're like, oh, thumbs up is like, it's like, like, you're insulting people, like, you're being sarcastic or rude. And I'm like, I don't know where they get all these thoughts from. It's really strange. Like, I thought it just meant like thumbs up. Like, I didn't. But now apparently it's something bad. Like, so I don't know. I still do it, but I guess younger people don't like it. I don't know. That's what I've heard. Some younger people, not all younger people. I think
I have a thumbs up thing in my subscribe. Do you want to see my pitch for people?
Yes, let's do that. Because that's okay. Thumbs up.
So if you guys haven't subscribed, add to Julia, subscribe now, and there's a thumbs up.
Yeah, for sure. It's great. Thank you for having me on. It was a lot of fun, Aya.
Okay, well, thanks for coming on. And next week, we're going to have Austin Peterson and his wife, Stephanie Peterson, and they have a book that they published about Calvin Coolidge, and it's all about how Calvin Coolidge was really cool. But anyway, Julia, I'm gonna see you every Friday in April.
Okay, sounds good.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye.